Maven, an expert, an authority, a connoisseur, a specialist, a professional, a knowledge king, a rock and roll sports talker. Coons Ford of Security Boulevard is proud to present The Sports Maven with Bruce Posner, a no-holds-barred look at the sports world. Now, here's Bruce Posner, The Sports Maven.
You know, sports has gotten to the point around here where I can't wait till tomorrow morning when England, my new favorite team in the World Cup, takes the field against Panama with a chance, all right, with a chance to move on. And look forward to it and do not look forward to the absolute collapse of Lionel Messi. What a disappointment. Especially when you watch how a guy like Ronaldo came through when it really mattered. Okay, that's cool. So let me get my boy Stan on the phone. Stan Charles, to talk a little Orioles. Stan, they're in the win column last night. What a game. Yeah. What a game.
They kept me up rather late last night, Bruce. They didn't win until 1:05 in the morning.
Well, in the 14th inning, when I saw him go 1-2-3 again, I said, you know what? I just fell asleep, and I woke up, and I went back, and because I had it DVR'd, and I could not believe they won. It was a tip. Yep. It was a game they've lost 9 times this year.
Well, the amazing thing, really, when you think about it, is why in the world, when Gentry gets on by hit by pitch, and then Wins sacrifices him to second base, how does a Snitker pitch to Manny Machado there?
Stupidity, that's why. I guess because he hasn't hit a home run in a while.
They wanted to go home,
yep.
Stan.
Yeah, they went home all right. They went home. They went home quickly. All right.
Yep.
But Manny, you know, got it. But I tell you what really bothered me, and it's bothered me a lot lately, Stan. In the 10th inning, I forgot you got a walk. How did he get to second base? I forgot. It wasn't a bunt. Oh, he stole base. He stole second.
Base.
Yeah, Manny stole second. Wild pitched to third.
Right.
One out. Can't somebody put their bat on the ball? This is just...
Well, that's been a season-long problem. There's no question about it. Yeah, that was pretty frustrating.
That was, no to me, that was like, that's it. We're losing the home run, bottom of this inning, and that'll be it. I mean, but it's not what happened in Britain. Now... You know, it's one thing, you know, you bring in Britain to close a game out. You're up 7-3, you know, to get a base hit, to get another base hit, to get another base hit. Stan, does it come to a point where you say, you know, he doesn't have it tonight?
Yeah. they were not prepared for that eventuality that Zach Britton would just be awful.
Maybe
really unprepared for it.
Maybe he didn't want to bring in O'Day, okay? But he brought him in anyway.
Okay? Yep.
And O'Day got out of the inning. It was a miracle we got out of that inning. And what a play, what a relay play to get the guy at the plate. I mean, it was... That game was one for the ages. And I didn't start watching it until the 8th inning. All right? I was out of the party. I came home and said, I started watching it and I said, well, you know, another loss. You know, what else is new? And then that great 9th inning and to waste. You there? We lost him? Okay. Call him back. Okay. Stan? Stan? Okay. Give him a call back, Dan. So
it was a late game, man. I mean...
Maybe he fell asleep. I don't know. Okay. We'll keep going. So anyway, where do the Orioles go? All right. From here, they are like nowhere. And it was a great win. But you keep losing. You get swept by the Nationals. You come back to win. Although I will say this, when Alex Cobb goes 7 innings and pitches a near perfect game in the Oriole eyes of only giving up one run, which was questionable anyway, the pitching isn't really the problem. But now it's like the bullpen. It goes from it goes from one problem to another. Stan, you back? You back, Stan?
Yep. I apologize. I have no idea what happened.
Oh, you just lost.
I heard you, and I was talking, and you couldn't hear me. Okay. I don't know what happened.
Stan, right. I was just saying that it's funny how, you know, Cobb, let's give him credit. What an outing yesterday, okay? It was fantastic, and there's been many of those, Stan. You know, this team should not be on this tailspin.
Discussing whether they should be on this tailspin or not right now is they are. I mean, they're, you know, there's not one prognosticator from you to me that could have predicted anything. So it is what it is. The big story last night, really, and there were so many big stories to that game last night, but the amazing story was that Chris Davis comes back and knocks in two runs and looked a little bit like he could be a contributor. I don't know.
Stan, I'll tell you why that's a big story.
The last 8 days, but it's pretty amazing. It's absolutely pretty amazing.
Stan, I'll tell you why that's a big story. Because it only shows the ignorance of the organization not to have done this on May 1st.
All right?
To wait this long. I hope he comes on and I hope he does great. He sure looked good last night, even hitting foul balls. He only missed two pitches the whole night. But why wasn't this done sooner? Why did you suffer through a three-month disaster?
Well, I mean, that was the thing from four weeks ago that came public, is that he hadn't done the work that I think the organization assumed he had during the offseason somehow, is put in the time to do that. And that's the night that Jim Palmer told the story that he had only worked with Scott Kulbaugh for three times, you know. So shame on Chris, but the bottom line is they owe over $100 million, and you would hope that whatever was going through his head, that there's been an adjustment, that he's willing to put in some type of work to change as a hitter and get back to being productive. You know, I before we had the phone problem, though, I did want to make one point about Britton. It seemed last night to go beyond that, but we have seen relief pitchers who get up to come into a game when it looks like they're going to close out a game, and that's what happened with Zach last night. Is maybe he's not used to the adrenaline rush of pitching in the ninth inning to begin with right now, and then the inning went on and on and on. And maybe that's just what happened to Zach, is mentally, once we had a four-run lead, he went into a different zone than Zach Britton does. So I'm willing to give him, I have not liked what I've seen from him, but I'm willing to give him last night a sort of a mulligan, and put the mulligan more on the manager for not being somewhat prepared for that eventuality.
No, but look, he's had, you know, everybody has blow-ups. Every reliever does, and last night was one of them. But why leave him in for a shellacking, all right, when it's just not there?
Well, because they just weren't prepared. And when you think about it, the way he's looked, I think Buck and Zach both suffer from a little bit of, oh, we got this game. I mean, you know, what would have the harm been to sort of start O'Day warming up at that point? Was that guy? Something's happened to O'Day where now he's never usable a second day. You know, if he'd gotten up and been warm and Britton had gone 1-2-3, that would have rendered him useless today. I don't know what's happened to him, you know, because he looked fine last night pitching. I don't know what's happened to his usability factor. Used to be that was one of the attractive things about Darren O'Day. And why you paid him $8 million a year is he could come back and pitch back-to-back days. You almost always hear Buck say, well, I couldn't go to Darren today. I couldn't use him back-to-back. And that was one of the great values he had.
Stan, do you hear any rumblings that the Nationals might be thinking a little bit of, you know, Bryce Harper au revoir and looking at Manny?
No, I haven't heard that. And they would not go in the direction of Manny. If they were going to let Bryce Harper go au revoir, it would be because they have two of the great young outfielders in the game in Juan Soto, who at 19 years old, I got to tell you, I've been around, you know, baseball for a long time, Bruce. That is one of the greatest 19-year-old hitters I've ever seen. His plate discipline, his calm, his ability to work a pitcher. He's just a brilliant, brilliant hitter. And then they have a player in Victor Robles who got hurt early this season, who was a little more advanced age-wise. I have not seen Robles play more than once or something like that, so I'm not quite sure how good he is compared to Soto, but that's the reason you wouldn't sign Harper, is because you got two players of that magnitude. You wouldn't do it and then sign another $28.5 to $30 million player.
Okay, maybe. I don't know what's going to happen, but I'm waiting to see what happens.
I think they'll still take their shot at Harper. Let's see. The season's long. If Chris Davis could come back after what he's gone through, after 8 days in purgatory and another 2 months nearly in purgatory, let's not write Harper's epitaph that he's going to finish at 200 or 205. He's much too good a hitter, and he'll probably still hit 38 home runs,
yeah,
40 home runs.
No,
I still think they're going to take a shot at signing him, but because of the uncertainty about Robles' injury. But they certainly have one heck of a player in Soto, and they get him now for 5 years. You know, making a minimum amount of money.
You know, it's funny that you have to remember that usually the Nationals draft below the Orioles. I mean, after the Orioles. And it's something about that. Something's wrong, you know. But we got to let you go real quick. Are you watching England tomorrow in the World Cup? You getting up 8 o'clock?
No, I'm not getting up at 8 o'clock.
All right. You haven't been sold yet.
I have not seen a World Cup game yet. I'm ready to get into, what are they, going into the second round now?
Well, most likely after tomorrow, the second round will be secure for England. And,
right.
You know, stand?
Who are some of the favorites right now? Like Portugal and...
I would say Spain and Brazil.
Belgium. I've heard Belgium has a good team.
The U.S. plays them next week, which could turn out to be a meaningless game. And, of course, Argentina's out because of the choke of Lionel Messi.
Right.
And, you know, but
and
it's always...
Has Germany played their second game yet?
Germany, I do not... Maybe today, I think today they're playing their second game. They'll bounce back, and I got to think that Mexico's in there. I really do.
Right.
All right, when they defeated Germany. But Stan, you got to get on the Harry Kane bandwagon, man. All right.
He's the best. Who's he play for?
England. Come on, Tottenham. What's wrong with you?
Okay, I'm on that bandwagon.
Maybe I'll go to work for you as a World Cup rep.
I'm having enough trouble staying on the Orioles bandwagon to pick up the Tottenham wagon.
That bandwagon for the time being is left town, all right?
Not a pleasant.
Hey, you know what? I'll let you go. I got one more statement to make.
Yeah,
everybody knocks the attendance. Everybody says how bad it is. I think the attendance is fantastic. If this team draws 1.8 or 2 million people, like it, you know, or 1.7.
No, they're on the pace right now to draw 1.5.
All right.
Right now.
1.5. Okay, lose that number.
Right, which would be the lowest in the history of the stadium.
Okay, and you know what? The team's going to lose 110 games.
Yep.
All right.
It looks that way.
And
right
you
now.
Still have a 1.5 million people coming out to watch the game. And to me, you see what the bottom is. And nobody likes the bottom. But a 1.5 million bottom is bad. But it's not the end of the world for a team that loses 110 games. You don't see people with bags over their head like other places would have it. You don't see people down on him. You rarely even ever heard Chris Davis getting booed. What would if he was a Yankee? What would happen to him?
The booing part, and I do have a couple more minutes. I was just late getting started today because I have a 10 o'clock show, but I got two or three more minutes. The attendance, they've gotten hit from Freddie Gray to the weather to the lack of transparency the past 6 months as to what's going on. They've gotten hit with every possible conceivable a damning thing that could happen to a baseball team. And they're partly responsible for some of it. Some of it's out of their control. But I've been a little bit disappointed in the 9,000 fan games. You know, listen, I'm not suggesting that they deserve to be attended by 30,000 a game. Baseball attendance across the board is down about 6%. The Orioles are down, I think I read the other day, 29%. And clearly a lot of that, Bruce, is the weather. A lot of that is how poorly they've played. But I've been surprised at sort of the apathy that I sense from Baltimore sports fans right now toward both of their teams. And it'll be interesting to see if the Ravens can sort of fish for their fans and get them to come back out to games. It'll be very interesting to see because we've both been around this town for a long time. I can't remember a moment in time that fans have been so cynical about their baseball and their football team at the same time.
Wait a minute, Stan. Let's be fair. I mean, the Orioles have given them. You know, the Ravens were 8-8. You can make a good case for that. Of course, they played the most boring brand of football in the history of football.
It's no question about it.
That'll change this year. It will change.
I agree. There's reasons on both sides, but it's just something I'm not used to seeing. You know,
well,
I'm not used to so much cynicism, sarcasm about our home teams. And some of it's justified, there's no question about it. But it's just going to be interesting to see, because I've never seen it taking place at the same time. You know, you've had times where Raven fans, you know, sort of, and the Raven organization sort of thumb their nose at the Orioles, and you've had times the other way around. But to see fans so sort of disengaged with both of the teams, it's a little disconcerting.
Yeah.
It's what I do for a living, you know. So,
yeah. All right. Well, you know, we're at the bottom of the barrel right now, so they can't do any worse. And to me, it's about winning, you know, and also about playing too many night games in April. They got to, like every other team in baseball, they got to sprinkle in some more day games. Because I'll tell you why, even though the day games might not draw tremendously a lot more people, at least the fans don't go there and get tortured. All right, from being in the cold and the rain, it's like it's ridiculous. I mean, I see a day game attendance with the Nationals is excellent, and I don't know. We'll move on from bad news. That's all.
All right,
Stan.
Right,
thanks for coming on.
Thank you very much for putting up with me this morning. It was a zoo at the beginning when you called.
No problem.
All right, bud.
Take care.
See you soon.
Bye-bye. All right, back in a few minutes here on CBS Sports Radio 1300. That past segment was brought to you by Coons Ford of Baltimore. Coons Ford is always in first place. They never have a bad year. And they are the top of the game. And Dennis Kalatsis and the crew are just fantastic. Their inventory is off the charts. Their service department's the best. And, yeah, I'm a devoted customer of Coons Ford of Security Boulevard in Baltimore. Get out today. If you're going to buy a car, you'll have the best lunch you ever had in your life. This is Bruce Posner. You are listening to Coons Ford Presents a Sports Maven. We'll be back in a few minutes here on CBS Sports Radio 1300.
Welcome back to Sports Maven, presented by Coons Ford of Security Boulevard. Now, once again, here's Bruce Posner, the Sports Maven.
So Thursday night, I was a happy camper, Danny, because my guy, Kevin Herter, all right, drafted 19th. I think that scoped in around $2.2 million. Originally, I didn't want him to go to Atlanta because Atlanta's been such a floundering franchise. But I have that vision of Trey Young and Kevin Herter. You know, you think about, what do you think about Curry and Klay Thompson? Now, these are stretches, but
quite.
All right, not quite. They're stretches with Trey Young, with Herter and Clay Thompson. Herter is not as good a shot as Clay Thompson, but you know what? He's not bad.
No, he's not bad.
He's not bad, and he's a kid who could average this first year if he gets playing time, you know, double digits. All right, I haven't studied enough about Atlanta's roster to know who's there that's going to keep.
It's not very good, but they have things to be excited about. They've drafted pretty well. They've gotten good value for their picks. They drafted the Bucknell kid, Muscala, a couple years ago, who's this big 6'11 long forward. And, I mean, they should be able to stretch the floor. I mean, this is the direction that the league is going. The problem is they don't really have the wings, but they are wanting to market Kevin Herter as one of those wings. Where he can play sneaky long. And he can hit any shot. And it's going to be interesting to see how his shot plays in the NBA as soon as he gets there and with Trae Young. I wouldn't be surprised if that team really struggles this year. But, you know, I mean, they could be especially if Trae Young blows up and Kevin Herter has success early on, that could be a very formidable backcourt, that's for sure. I mean, you look at what the Trailblazers do in the West with Damian Lillard and CJ McCollum. I mean, there's no reason why Herter and Young couldn't be that, but at the same time, like you said, they're not exactly on a team that looks, you know, destined to take a huge step forward, but they might.
Well, probably not right away. I mean, Trae Young is only, 18 or 19 years old. I mean, he's not going to dominate the league. But
when was the last time a Terps player got taken this high?
It's been a while.
Yeah.
It's been a while. Alex Lynn was taken fifth.
Right, but this is an exciting thing for the Terps fans. I know Twitter was blowing up about how Kevin Herter was taken in front of Grayson Allen. That was a very exciting moment.
And did you notice how Jay Billis had Grayson Allen rated over Kevin Herter?
You think that's a little bit of home cooking by Billis?
But I tell you what, Grayson Allen is lucky because he really went to a great team to go to Donovan Mitchell. And I don't know if you saw the love there.
Yeah.
Donovan Mitchell came over and hugged him. And, you know, and Grayson Allen's smile was 2 feet wide because he's going to, with Donovan Mitchell, you're going to get your open shots all day.
Yeah.
There's not even a question
about
it.
He's going to be, and listen, I'm not sure if his scrappy play is really going to play in the NBA. I mean, the way that he's able to bully and be a nudge in the ACC might not play when you're playing against these veteran bigger guys than you. But, I mean, he could be that scrappy enforcer, too.
Listen, he can play. He can play, just like J.J. Redick can play. There was a lot of question about whether J.J. Redick would make it. And what he got paid last year, $20 million.
J.J. Redick has had a very good NBA career.
If he never played another game, he made $20 million last year to play 1 year for the 76ers. And he delivered.
Yeah, he was the leader on that team.
You can name, if they go after LeBron and are forced to drop him, which is probably what would happen, you can name 10 teams that could use J.J. Redick.
Absolutely. No, I mean, the NBA scope right now, starting with the draft on Thursday, I mean, it's only going to get wackier. I mean, with all these free agency moves around and stuff, and Dwight Howard getting traded to the Nets and then opting out, and now, I mean, there's already rumors of him joining the Warriors.
Ugh.
I mean, there's going to be a lot of interesting moves around. I mean, Kawhi Leonard, it looks like he's between a rock and a hard place with the Spurs, and we're going to see a lot of interesting developments in the next few weeks in the NBA.
Yeah, it's no doubt. To me, it was a shame that Kevin didn't go to the draft.
Right.
Because Turgeon could have gotten a lot of good pub, just like the other coaches who were there did. You even saw Larinaga there when they drafted Lonnie Walker.
I mean, Calipari was there, and even Izzo showed his face. Izzo was hanging out there.
Well, any guy who's going to be taken in the first round should be there. Any coach should, because in some part of a way, it's a credit to the coach. Atlanta's a great fit for Kevin, said Turgeon. I'm so happy I had the opportunity to spend the night in Albany with Kevin, his family, and some of our team. The Hawks are getting a great player, person, even better teammate. I'm so excited for the next step in Kevin's life and can't wait to follow his career. Kevin Herter, you know, he's one of those guys who's played for Maryland, and needless to say, I've seen them all. But he's one of those guys that you think to yourself, get the ball in his hands when you have to have a point.
Yeah.
And even though Maryland's record was certainly not great this year, Kevin Herter was great. And he hit the threes that had to be hit. He would get into a run and spur the team on. And he hits NBA threes. I don't think that's even. I don't think the line's even a factor to him.
You're absolutely right. And the thing about Herter too, and even in his freshman year, he was consistently that guy who was making the big hustle plays to keep the team in it and stuff. I mean, he was. I've said this on Terry Ford's show a bunch of times, and he agrees. I mean, he was probably my most favorite Terp to watch in the last 2 years. He just seemed to always be in the right position to make a good play. And I would imagine, you know, that core IQ and his, you know, good. Obviously, that stroke from three helps a lot, too. But his draft prospects went up way, way, way up when he got to go to the combine and show how his measurables stacked up. And hopefully that hand will be all healed up. I mean, I'd love to see him in summer league, but that might be.
That's not going to happen.
Yeah.
It's not going to happen. Herter averaged 12 points, 5 rebounds, and 3 assists per game in his career. I mean, that's a steady overall number.
Absolutely.
Got to improve his defense, obviously, like every kid going to the pros. It's very few of them, except for the kid I told you and I raved about. He made it to the second pick in the second round, and that's Javon Carter from West Virginia. I think people were sleeping on him, and I think that this is a guy who's going to do great in the NBA because he's so ferocious. Now, Justin Jackson.
There you go. I was about to say.
Was selected in the second round, as expected, pick number 43 by Denver for about 6 minutes and then traded to Orlando. Mm-hmm. All right. Grayson Allen joined Donovan Mitchell in Utah. Moritz Wagner from Michigan was drafted in 25th by the Lakers.
And that was a rumored potential landing spot for Kevin Herter. There was reports out saying that the Lakers wouldn't let Herter drop past the 25 pick.
Yeah, I think that's the case, but they didn't trade up for him. I mean, you always look at how bad somebody wants somebody.
Exactly. There's a lot of moving around in that draft the other day, too, especially with Doncic and Trae Young. I mean, we were mentioning Trae Young earlier.
Don't think winning doesn't have its value. 4 members of Villanova were drafted. Number 10, Mikal Bridges, in one of the saddest things of the night, being drafted for his hometown team by the 76ers, where his mother works, and within about 4 minutes, he was traded.
Yep.
All right, but that's life. It happens. Dante DiVincenzo, number 17. And this is the MVP of the national championship game. I think he had 31 points. Number 30 was Omari Spellman. 30 would make him the last pick in the first round, guaranteed money, and great, 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 like, scrappy player, scored inside, a big reason they won the title. And then it's funny, maybe the guy who had the highest, you know, measurables coming into college and whatever, Jalen Brunson goes the bottom of those 4, and he went number 33. Kind of reminds you of Steve Blake and Juan Dixon that, you know, Blake was drafted in the second round, had the longest career. But Juan was the, like Brunson, Juan was the face of the Terrapin Championship team. Had an okay career, went to Europe, now coaching over at Coppin State. A little surprise, Tony Carr from Penn State went 51st to the Pelicans. Dr. Casey Vincent Edwards from Purdue was selected 52nd by Utah. And, of course, Miles Bridges from Michigan State was taken 12th by the Clippers and then traded to Charlotte. And the Wizards, in their unexciting self, their unexciting ways, drafted Troy Brown Jr., from, was it Oregon?
Yeah.
And then in the second pick, I don't even know who they picked, but they took a pick where they didn't have to take a player, which happens a lot in the second round, especially with the Wizards. That second pick is, you know, long known. I don't know. To me, sometimes you go to the top 40 players, and that would be it, as Belgium is crushing Tunisia 4-1, which is what the Britain score should have been, but it wasn't.
And we were talking about it off air, Bruce. The English generally tend to play down to their opponent, and I'm partial to Belgium because there's a lot of current and ex-Chelsea players on there, including Eden Hazard, who scored that 4th goal. So how do you feel about the World Cup so far? Are you enjoying it?
I love it. Of course, being retired and being able to watch the games, and it's a different light than being able to watch the games without being at work and turning it on. And
the time difference isn't that bad. Having these morning to afternoon games, pretty good.
Right. But when you're at work, it's hard to watch a game.
Well, I mean, I haven't been able to watch much of it at all, right. Unfortunately.
Right. But. So, you know, maybe you snuck in a few minutes of the England game.
Exactly.
But, you know, I watched it wire to wire, and I'm having some people over the house Sunday to watch game number two against Panama, which is kind of a crucial game for England. If they don't win, they have to win that. They will win that, I would hope. Although you never know.
Harry Kane.
You never know. Harry Kane, 2 goals. He came through when it mattered. You know, there's a rule that they have in the World Cup that bothers me. On these corner kicks, I didn't know that players were allowed to tackle players and take them to the ground. How could that be acceptable?
It's not.
It is.
Not by rule. It's not.
But they don't call it.
I mean, it depend. I mean, if it's a 50-50 jump ball, there's been a lot of play on. I'll say that. And so far in the World Cup, there has been a lot of let them play physicality from the officials, and maybe, I mean, there could be a variety of reasons for that. I mean, we know that the missed penalty from Messi probably doomed the entire World Cup run for Argentina. So maybe I don't know. Maybe they're trying to lessen those penalty kicks, because it is a very it's pretty accepted now that while penalty kicks are a part of soccer, soccer fans really do not love the penalty kick because it's kind of an arbitrary momentum swing.
And, in these games that they play, so if it's tied, there's no penalty kicks.
No, not yet. It's
in this round of 16,
In the round of 16, there is after. I'm pretty sure it's 2 15-minute. It's called not golden goal, but silver goal. So they play the two halves, no matter what.
Right.
And then if they're still tied after the 30 minutes, they go to a penalty kick.
So the quarterfinals is not a two match situation. It's a knockout.
Yes.
Okay. So seeding is important. Now, how do they base seeding, or is it random?
I actually think it is random. After the top two teams from each group get brought into the 16.
Well, there's one
team.
And two.
Yeah.
In other words, the 8-1 teams play the 8-2 teams.
Yes.
So they're saying that selection is
right.
Random.
Yeah. They generally in soccer it is a draw circumstance. So it's going to be interesting where that.
So that
comes
does
out.
Make the England Belgium game huge.
A little bit.
Because you get the number one seeding and you avoid. Well, you might not avoid Germany. I don't know. You got to win no matter.
Tune in and find out.
You got to win no matter what. But back to basketball for a second. Where's LeBron going to wind up? It seems to me that L.A. is his landing point if they try and do another super team.
Right.
But you're starting to hear rumbles that his wife might not want to leave Cleveland because the kids are there and the kids are happy. It's a big factor.
It is a big factor.
And he's going to make $20 million or $30 million wherever he goes. So, that you know, I don't know if money's the factor. Well, I think it's winning is the factor. But there's guys out there, you know, what if they get Kawhi to go to Cleveland for a year?
Yeah. I would doubt that simply because the Cavs are lacking assets in a way that the Lakers aren't. It would be easier for the Lakers to turn their team into a super team from what they have here than the Cavs redoing it again for a third
time.
Yeah,
but the Lakers, if they have to do that and they have to make a deal with San Antonio, they're going to lose Kuzma, they're going to lose Brandon Ingram, and that could turn out to be a disaster.
Well, if they can lure in Paul George and LeBron James and trade for Kawhi, I'm pretty sure they would do that. And I think Magic is looking for a way to get out from under Lonzo anyway at this point. But, I mean, I think you're right that it's probably, and Dwayne Wade said as much in an interview a couple weeks ago, that LeBron's decision is not going to be as much of a basketball decision as many would think. It's going to come a lot down to the fact that his son, LeBron James Jr., is an all-country prep player who looks to basically his next stop is going to be his last stop before Division One, and they want to put him at a high school where he can be very successful. Now, he could stay in Akron and go to the same high school that LeBron went to, and there's that whole appeal, but he could also go to L.A., or he could also go to Houston. I feel like there's going to be a lot of intrigue. You're going to see a lot of Twitter sleuths out there trying to figure out if LeBron's wife is visiting high schools, you know, that sort of thing, but it's going to be very interesting. Where would you like to see him?
I'd like to see him stay in Cleveland.
You would like to?
Yeah,
I think that'd be the best narrative
for
the NBA?
I think that his legacy would be enhanced if he stayed in Cleveland. If he says he's got 3 more years left,
okay,
all right, and could figure out a way to win one more. I think the fact that he stayed, and I do believe, at first I'm thinking definitely the Lakers, and then I'm starting to think when I hear his wife has an influence. So he's a happily married man, All right. He's got three kids.
Yep.
All right. One's a superstar player. If his kid, you know, as a father, you know, and your son's a great athlete, that kind of takes precedence over everything. And you know right now, where is he on the path for? He's on the path to play for Krzyzewski at Duke, all right? And probably, or maybe not, because Krzyzewski could be gone. But he'll go to the best program in the country and be featured and have that path right to the NBA. And I guarantee you, that's more important to LeBron than anything.
And that's why LeBron wants to try to do what he can to play for another 4 years or so, because apparently they want to do a whole Ken Griffey Jr., Ken Griffey Sr. thing. And that's going to be very interesting to watch
where
that might happen.
Well, that's a lot to ask from his body. But anyway, let's get out to the second break. And the second segment was brought to you by Science and Kirk, all right, Danny's employer, and the number one firm in Maryland for, and actually in the country for personal injury claims.
All over the country, Bruce.
It is amazing. You take a lot of calls from around the country.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. I was talking to someone from Montana the other day. And it's crazy. The scope of Science and Kirk will never cease to amaze me. That we have amazing service no matter who we are. We find the best attorneys to work with on the personal injury claims, and call 1-800-LAWYERS. You've got a lawyer.
Yeah, you know what? It's amazing what Donald Science has done with advertising, how he has spread the name of Science and Kirk all over the country. And his theory was this. He says, when another guy advertises and does a lot, I do more. All right? And he never stops, and he delivers. And that's the bottom line. If you don't deliver, all the advertising in the world doesn't work. But he does all the advertising in the world and does deliver. All right, with that, we'll be back in a few minutes here on Coons Ford presents the Sports Maven.
This is the Sports Maven Show, presented by Coons Ford of Security Boulevard. Now, here's the Maven himself, Bruce Posner.
So as a golf enthusiast who is down right now, not able to play because of sciatica, all right, painful pinched nerve in my thigh and on the side of the right leg. Painful, I'll leave it at that. Still love golf no matter what. I mean, I love watching it. I really love playing it. But I still, you know, in fact, yesterday I watched the third round of the Travelers Open. Not many people. I mean, I've watched the whole thing. Anyway, I wrote the following in TurfTalk.com, Danny. And I got blasted a little bit by it, and I got approved by it. As many sports columnists have now given Lefty a pass on his disgraceful performance on Saturday, let it be said, don't include me on that list. To me, it is incomprehensible that he wasn't immediately DQ'd and created some idiotic story about it being a logical move, and now he's totally apologized for it. That story to me was the worst. Instead of just saying I had a brain lapse, I had a brain freeze, which is probably what it was, all right? He created a story that he was within the rules. A lot of golf fans like myself wait for Father's Day to enjoy time with the family and then to what? To watch the final day of the U.S. Open. He didn't ruin it because the Brooks Koepka run was fantastic. But on Saturday, Phil didn't bend the rules. He downright cheated by intentionally hitting a moving ball. Now, according to the rules, and I was told this by a rules expert, a guy actually on the PGA Rules Committee last night, that what he did, all right, there's no precedence to or not, but there's no rule against it. And the fact that he can say it wasn't with forethought or it wasn't a calculated move is in his favor as to not being disqualified. However, he insulted the game and, more important, let down his legions of fans, including myself. And then, of course, the ultimate insult, and this is what got me the most, Danny, was laughing it off in the press interviews. All right? So he's apologized to golf, to the golf world, and he needs to admit, which he did, that he royally messed up, because you know what? That's the truth. So I got all kinds of emails that, you know, it's stupid. How can you jump on a guy like that who's done so much for golf? And this, you know, all kinds of comments like that, guys who love Phil. But if you're a real fan of golf and you watch that take place. You know, it's one thing when a guy's assessed a two-shot penalty because, you know, he put a towel on his knee and didn't realize that was helping to support his stature, and it's against the rules, like Craig Stadler, or when, you know, there's so many stupid rules in golf. The old rule that if you address the ball and it just moved an inch, that was a penalty when you had no cause for making it happen. Or what happened yesterday, 15 seconds a ball fell in the hole and you only have 5 seconds. So even though it fell in the hole, it was still a one-shot penalty, except the stroke counted. So it's like it didn't fall in the hole. There's a lot of silly rules, all right? But this was egregious, in my opinion.
Well, somebody please think of the children.
No, it's not that bad. But you know what? I'm watching it happen with my granddaughter, who's certainly not an expert on golf. And she said, "You never told me you could hit a ball while it's moving." And I can't tell you how many times I've seen guys hit putts, and like 3-foot putts, and they miss it.
Right.
And before it gets the hole, they swat it away.
Yeah.
Well, yeah, that's wrong too, except this ain't the U.S. Open.
Right. No, that's the case.
This is for a $2 Nassau.
Yeah.
Right?
No, that's true. I mean, for me as a younger fan, I mean, I just kind of empathize with his initial take on it, and that it was a moment of frustration. And I thought, like, the candor, while I totally understand where you're getting from in retrospect, and it's exacerbated by the fact that you basically walked it all back with what seems now that to be a phony apology. Like, that seems a little much.
Well, the new one's better.
Right, right. But it's just, I mean,
apology number two was better.
Right. But I mean, for me, it was I could kind of understand, and I feel like that's where most casual golf fans came on the side of Phil, is like, oh, well, we've all been there. But you're right. I mean, it's the U.S. Open. You would hope that one of the greater golfers of this generation was able to do better. But hey, we were talking about it off the break. I mean, you made the case that this could be a loophole or a precedent to set to help cheats. And I'm not sure if it will, but if there's one thing that we've been proven from Phil Mickelson's personal life, is that he's not exactly the most up-and-up guy, at least when it comes to gambling and income taxes.
Here's where it comes to, okay? And I'm not judging him on that stuff. I'm judging him on golf, and I never thought he would.
Well, if you're judging him just on golf, he's a cheat too.
Yeah. Yeah, no, only on golf.
Right.
Only on golf. Here's where something could happen. You got a downhill putt. You're 50 feet away. And what's at the end of the green? Water. So you put the ball too hard. All right, and you don't want it to go in the water.
Do you go chasing after it?
Yeah, because then the ball could go in the water, and you've got to go to the other side of the grass and go over the water back onto the green.
It's worth just taking two shots, right?
In that case, it is worth taking two shots. So you prevent it from going into a hazard, and you putt the ball, you know you're in trouble. And then what about same thing happens again? And you're facing that could happen. You run down, and why not stop the ball right next to the hole? In other words, what kind of rule is it? And I guarantee you,
it's going to be changed.
It will be addressed.
Yes.
All right, it will be addressed. And I'll leave it at that, and I won't mention it again, I promise. But it will definitely be addressed.
Any lacrosse updates for this week?
Lacrosse updates. The Bayhawks are at home tonight. Playing, I think, the Boston Cannon, I think. The big game for the Bayhawks is July 21st when the University of Maryland Charlotte Hornets come to town.
Nice.
They are loaded with Terps.
Okay.
All right, loaded. I mean, Rambo will be back in town and just everybody. So I look forward to that. And, of course, Atlanta still came to town last week with Connor Kelly. And, like, you know, second game, you don't just walk into the MLL and take over. But Nico Amato has replaced the injured Brian Phipps in the net and just been absolutely unbelievable, allowing only 7 or 8 points a game, 8 goals a game, which is incredible in that league. It is that scores are normally 16 to 15 and stuff like that. And we are about out of time. Looking forward to see if the Orioles can get a 2-game win streak. All right?
It'd be 3 or 4.
And most important, tomorrow, England. Old England, all right? And Harry Kane and Dele Alli and Kyle Walker and Trippier.
Yeah.
Another Tottenham player. And Sterling from Manchester City. And whoever.
Yeah.
Anybody from Liverpool?
I'm sure.
All right. Anybody from...
From Chelsea? Yeah. Gary Cahill's just hanging around somewhere.
Out of time, everybody. Have a great weekend.